All right, so welcome to another episode of The Restaurant Report. My name is Paul Barron, I'll be your host today. We're gonna dive into, as you guys know, our Restaurant Innovator series, and it's something we've been doing here on the network. And now one thing you will notice also is we've brought back a lot of our video. If you'll remember post-pandemic or pre-pandemic, Foodable used to do most all of our content in video. And of course it had an audio format. We're bringing that back here in studio now. We've got, of course, a much better capability of going back out on location, all that kind of cool stuff. But we're doing this Restaurant Innovator series, and this is another installment of that one. And so thanks for stopping in today. We're going to dive into an interesting topic I think you guys are going to want to know, and that is how to grow a brand in 2023. What does it look like? Who are some of the players out there? What are their, you know, secret sauce aspects of growing businesses in what I think is a little bit of a challenging time? So we're going to dive into all that good stuff. And again, this is going to be a good one. Let's get into it today with our guest. And that is Scott Ford, who is the president and co-CEO with Hawaiian Bros. So welcome to the show, Scott.
Thank you. I appreciate you having me.
Very cool stuff. So we had a chance to talk prior to the show today. Kansas City based, love Kansas City. I'm one of those cities in the Midwest that just you kind of fall in love with just in their allure to great brands that are built there, but also just the people and everything you guys have done around business in the central United States, which is kind of cool. We don't find many fast casual brands that are birthed out of there, though, which is kind of nice to see you guys coming out of KC for sure. So how many units are you guys up to now?
36 and 37 coming a week from Tuesday.
Wow. Okay, so lots of growth. When you look at the situation that we've kind of dealt with over the past couple of years, you guys grew through that. What was one of the things that you were able to, one, identify for Hawaiian Bros or Hawaiian Bros that kind of helped you get through that very challenging period of time, especially for fast casual, even though fast casual did benefit, I think, a lot from what happened, you know, with mobile ordering, digital, all that. What was it that worked for you guys to kind of grow the brand in tough times?
Yeah, I mean, there certainly were tough times. We didn't allow ourselves to worry about it or, you know, get too wound up over it. We just were nimble enough to pivot when things got tough. The focus for us has always been speed. We needed to leverage each of our physical plants and get the most that we could out of them. So we got fast. That's just how we could do it. I only have 4 digital parking spaces, so I need to turn those over a lot quicker than we had been if we're going to increase that piece of our business. And as you had indicated, digital became a big piece of our growth.
Yeah. You came from fast food, casual dining, so you've been in the business for a very long time. Franchising models you've seen. You guys have now introduced a new franchising model for Hawaiian Bros. So that usually is a little tough to do. In many cases, you look at franchising systems that do it from the get-go. They never really open a company store. They just open franchise systems.
Yeah.
You guys kind of did the opposite, built company stores. Now you're looking at the proof of case on the franchise side. Why go franchising and not continue the route of growing the brand through company operated units?
Well, here's what I tell you. We definitely are going to continue to grow a company. We're going to grow it at the pace that we have access to capital and that it makes, you know, sense for us. Our opportunity to generate capital is bound by the amount of equity we're willing to give up in the company. And, because capital is finite and there's a limited amount of it for us, we're able to grow restaurants faster. You know, most concepts spend the first decade or 15 years figuring out who they are. I was fortunate enough to walk into a concept that really had it pretty well clocked right out of the gate.
Yeah, exactly.
Very simple menu, great consumer response. And we spent the first 2 years of me here just validating that we had it right, doing, you know, all the consumer insights, testing the levers, seeing how high was up when we were talking about growing unit level. And and it every checked every box. So we're sitting here with a concept that we think is pretty pretty well wired, ready for the growth. We've demonstrated rapid growth, and there's a limited amount of it we can do on the company side. So let's share it. We know we've got at least 1,500 units worth of white space in the 48. So looking at that and the opportunity to grow over the next number of years, we figured we'd share it with some franchisees.
I think, yeah, and I think we've seen, I've had a chance to be in the fast casual sector for a long time. I started fastcasual.com, did the big summits when we were growing the sector in the mid-90s, had a chance to work with a lot of upstart operators. And franchising was always the question mark. It was always the unknown, whether or not they should do it, you know, because many people were like, hey, I'm too protective of the brand. I don't feel like, you know, we can grow it at scale. But in the other side of that is that, you know, capital intensive markets like restaurants, which require a lot of, you know, cap to be able to just get a unit economics right, you pretty much kind of have to go in that direction and use other people's money in essence, you know, to grow a brand. So I completely get it. And it's kind of a 50-50 split between all the guys I've interviewed, probably in the thousands in this sector, is some people fall on pro, some people fall on nope, we're going to go the company route. So kudos to you guys for making a run at it. The cool thing is, and I want to get into building a brand, because you guys have been able to do it in tough times, kind of put Hawaiian Bros on the map in a sector, especially fast casual, but in a culinary sector that's a little different. You know, you're not head-to-head with the big categories like Fresh Mex, Bakery Cafe, et cetera. You guys are going at it from a more of a culinary uniqueness. Do you feel like that is the differentiator for you guys when you go into a market and you go, you have to, you know, compete?
Yeah, I think you nailed it. It's interesting. You know, we made the Technomic 500, mm-hmm. You know, they categorized us in Asian noodle. I don't know that that's where I would go. I think if you look at the history of the Hawaiian plate lunch, you'll see that there are some Asian roots to that and
right.
where the island comes from. But the reality of it is we're probably more like Chipotle, and our consumers, when asked in our attitude awareness and usage study where they would eat if they hadn't eaten with us, Chipotle
right.
was the number one answer. So I think we share a lot of similarities there, the quantity, the price value, all of those things that drive that. To the point you're making, you know, there's something about Hawaiian Bros Island Grill. We have island inspired food. We wouldn't consider ourselves authentic Hawaiian. It's more island inspired flair, you know, the teriyakis, the
right.
Pineapple flavors. I think all those cues resonate with folks. And I think just even the name in and of itself, it means something to folks. We found that our barrier to trial is just awareness. We find if we drive awareness, trial follows very closely behind that. Mm-hmm. It different than a burger chain that has to make you aware of their concept and then have you leave your other favorite burger to come to them. For us, people hear that and say, well, that's intriguing. It's new.
Exactly. Yeah.
I'm gonna go try it.
Yeah. I think this is the thing, especially in the fast casual sector, when we look at the Restaurant Innovator Series is when we drop in here, we do this on another show called Fast Casual Nation as well. And we're trying to pick leaders in the market that are, they're starting to skirt in one, new sectors that are seeing growth. Typically it's culinary or they've got some sort of tactical model that has given them some, you know, some advantages in the market. For you guys, I was looking at just your unit economics, which I thought was very intriguing. I don't want to reveal them. I'll let you do that. But when you look at average unit volume, especially in fast casual, for you guys, I looked at your numbers and I thought, wow, this is significant. How are you able to do that? First of all, can you share your average unit volume, what you guys are doing out there in the market?
Yeah, so what you'd see in the Technomic 500, the restaurants that were open all of 2021, 4.6 million in a small box.
What's your footprint right now? 3,200 feet.
3,200 is our prototype. So got to go fast to put to put that kind of volume through there. It really is about speed. We have 29-second standard for our drive-through window. So we move people through quickly. DoorDash has us ranked as their number one chain for speed of turn on their, you know, they'll give you a gold star for being under 2 minutes and 30 seconds. And our average for them is 75 seconds. So that's from when that's the insane. Driver shows up to when they leave. And we're really focused on that. We know that, you know, other concepts have said they've had issues with driver shortages. We just don't experience mm-hmm. that. We feel like the drivers actually come, they'll show up to us and turn their app on so that they can immediately, we do so many
transactions. Well, it's the speed. You know, yeah. It's the speed kills, man. You can put out more orders. It's just like an Uber driver that they're dealing with. The faster I can get this done, you know, the more money I'm going to make, you know, from a driver standpoint. So I would agree with you. That still, to me, anything over really a 2.5 million AUV is astounding in the fast casual sector. So kudos to what you guys are doing out there. And you're not really doing, I was looking at your price points. They're not super high price points. So the number of volume pieces, what is your secret sauce around building that kind of demand? Is it been mostly through digital marketing? Where have you guys won in the area of being able to build to those AUVs?
We're good at digital marketing, but we're also, you know, one of the most astonishing things that we found in our attitude awareness and usage study was likelihood to recommend. Top two box, very likely, 98% likely to recommend. It was the most insane. Our guy that did the study for us was the head of research for Consumer Insights for Applebee's. And when he did the AAU, he said, I've never seen any product,
anything
campaign,
like that,
car, cell phone, anything that he's ever worked with score that high. But people leave our restaurants and they feel compelled to tell somebody about it. It's just that different from what they'd experienced.
Yeah, I was looking at your Instagram here. You guys have got a decent following here on Instagram. Great work here too. And I think the key here around digital marketing, love the food presentation. I'm just blown away by what you guys have been able to do, because this is something that is difficult to do, especially in the area of fast casual or upscale QSR, is one, be able to deliver a drive-through experience, then be able to deliver a travelable product that has scale in terms of quality. Because that's the magic, I think, that really people miss. You go to a Payway, we'll use an example of Payway. Yeah. They're pretty good on travel. The product, you know, if you get it right and you get it hot, it's going to hold and it does a fairly good job. But if you go to a Five Guys, I'm coming back with soggy fries and a crappy burger, you know, after 15 minutes. So I think that really makes for a benefit there. Have you seen that being the case for your takeout food of saying, people are really recommended because you get a really good travel capability?
Yeah, I like what you call travelability. I would never use this in marketing, but we call it durability. Our food it does carry well. It reheats well. It's good. It's just as good the next day. And that's part of our price value scores mm-hmm. is most often people indicate to us that this is dinner tonight and lunch tomorrow for them. And that drives the price value, but you're absolutely right. This food travels well. It's in, you know, and versus, you know, McDonald's, you know, that's part of their operating model. Leave the bag open so you can experience a hot fry, because they know, you know, a mile down the road that their product's degrading at a pace that they can't keep up with. Our product is just as good the next day.
Very cool stuff. I was looking at the design again, back to Instagram here. This was just some of your interior design. And Fast Casual is known for some high quality design in terms of the unit itself.
Yeah.
One, you know, very pleasing for people to come into, usually quick kind of grab and go kind of stuff. You guys have done a lot of interesting things here. Let's go back to that picture, because I want to showcase a couple of things. The warm wood colors. I like the way you did the tile wall there, that kind of gives it the, you know, kind of that professional customer base when they look at something in a restaurant. But at the same time, you're also using very legible, but also very approachable, which I think is an interesting thing, of not looking too much like food that people don't recognize? Because this is a problem that some brands will have, is they get so exotic, they kind of stand back and go, ooh, I don't know if I want to try that or not.
Yeah.
Versus what you guys have done. Very cool stuff. Did you guys have a designer? How was this all put together in terms of your store interiors?
Yeah, so what's interesting is I stumbled on unit one and I thought I'd missed a national chain. I've been doing this, mm-hmm. I was consulting, and I couldn't believe that I hadn't heard of these guys because of how it was just an awesome, interior design. The menu was simple. Everything about it blew me away. But when I found out it was the first restaurant, if I'm being honest and credit where credit is due, the two founders just have a real eye for this stuff. So they've got good instincts. We're working with great design firms that have really helped us enhance that even further, make it functional, make the economics of it strong. We have, when you go inside, that epoxy floor is made to look like the ocean floor and beach and everything. So it's kind of cool, but it's also very, functional in that you can, clean it easily. It stays clean, doesn't show wear. The outside of the building, they're beautiful. They're well lit. Yep. We addressed that early on with a glow at night intentionally. We really wanted to make sure that people saw us as a late night opportunity.
Yeah, this is good. Now, I was looking at your building design that we're showing on screen right now. So you got a double window there. On your drive-through, to be able to handle speed, are you doing dual lane drive-through, tandem? How do you guys handle your drive-through queue?
The longest pole in the tent is ordering. It's about 75 seconds. And then we can get the payment knocked out at one window and a beverage and get you order handoff in the present in the second window. So because of that, and because we want to move at a 30-second rate, we do have double and triple order points depending on the site.
I see that.
So double wide there. And then we also have our new prototype on the opposite side of the drive-through building is a window for delivery and curbside.
Yeah.
We're just going to hand it out the window.
That's so
we're going to do, what Chipotle is called the Chipotle lane, the digital lane on one side of the building, and then do traditional drive-through on the other. Where we have drive-through, it's 50% of our mix.
Yeah.
But we do so much off-premise that.
Yeah, I think the growth, that's a big factor, I think, when you look at brand growth in 2023. This was something that Don Fox and I talked about with Firehouse. So it's just an episode back, is digital has been such a big leap forward. How do brands maximize, one, that opportunity, but at the same time still build that customer hospitality engagement that really is restaurants? So sounds like you guys have been able to get a little bit of both of these things cooking. Speed, quality of the product itself, design, I think you guys are way ahead. This may be one of the few brands that I've seen in fast casual that could be the new DNA for the future. Because this has been something that everybody's asked. Drive-through is going to happen in fast casual. You just got to figure out how do you do it. And how do you get that throughput done? Because typically the cook times, prep times, even order times can be a little bit longer. As you look forward, when you think about growing a brand in 2023 and beyond, what area are you guys focusing in on now outside of franchising and building? Is there something operationally that you feel like, hey, we could do this better, or we think maybe there's an opportunity?
Yeah, so for us, it's all about speed and utilizing the physical plant the best we can. But the way that digital is unfolding and the way that the consumers are responding to our brand, we've got five digital kitchens, ghost kitchens with Kitchen United, with Cloud Kitchen, really looking for anything we can learn in that space. And we look at it as a manufacturing opportunity for us. We have a distribution opportunity. We have food that people love, they crave, they want to come back for it. and we need to get it to them. So I've got a ghost kitchen in Austin, Texas, in a 350 square foot kitchen inside of Kitchen United that's pumping up near 3 million out of that one business. Wow. So looking at a unit like that, we've learned a lot on miniaturizing our process so that we can get faster and more efficient inside the box that we do have. But we've also, learned that this brand could live in a virtual environment. Okay. Mm-hmm. So we're very much open to whatever the future holds as far as getting this in the consumer's hand. So it's interesting to me what you said. I believe people come in, they love the restaurant, they love the experience, they love the ukuleles and the ocean floor as they come in. They love our speed of drive through. And I think that occasion doesn't go anywhere. I think people are going to be out, they're going to be in their car, they're going to be hungry, and they want to intercept food right there. That's going to happen. Right. I think people are going to be out at work and they're going to want to eat away from work, so they're going to need a dining room. I think those occasions don't change, but the trajectory of delivery and where it's at and what it's meaning to our business, more than a fourth of our business now, and with our digital being north of 40% of our business, it is definitely something that has our attention. Can this be levered in a different prototypical format? So I think all prototypes will be part of our future growth, but I think you have to look at it and explore, can we be, right. Can we penetrate the market with alternate, units and mm-hmm. virtual units and all of those.
You have I think you guys have an opportunity here to really kind of be in a position. One, the brand seems to already have a lot of omni channels built into it. Drive through, really nice interior, so you can get that dynamic segment. You've got the digital sector wrapped up really tightly. And then now with franchising, to be able to translate all that into one. In terms of franchising, when you look at a brand that has omni-channel like this and they do it so well, I always ask the question, is this difficult to train someone who hasn't been in that operation to be able to run it at the level of efficiency that you guys are doing now?
Yeah, it's a good question because it is about speed, but we benefit from this. I have 6 menu items and 81 SKUs. So, coming from concepts that had north of 400 SKUs, 81 SKUs is a big deal. It really is. It is, one of our
big biggest advantage.
Points of advantage over other concepts that I've worked for. 6 menu items, the processes in the back of the house are simple. Since I've gotten here, we've taken the entire menu and worked on streamlining it. We've taken processes out of the restaurant and into co-packers so we can get some consistency and leverage that economics of that a little bit better. We've never, ever, and won't ever give on the quality of the product. So there's just a non-negotiable for us. I've been a part of that in past large chains that would yield, 1 or 2% in their mind on quality in the idea that they would gain some consistency. It's never going to be a thing for us, but to the simplicity of our concept, I can train a new employee in less than an hour to be 80% effective as a tenured employee on one position. It's one of our, you got a plate, 4 scoops, scoop of rice, scoop of rice, scoop of mac, scoop of meat. Let me train you on it. You'll be on the line and you'll feel 80%, you're part of the team that day one.
Yeah.
And versus coming in and being inundated with learn all of these things, we can teach mm-hmm. you to become, an effective member of the team. And it's so fulfilling to our new employees. And then from there, we cross train and they learn the other process. But it is about being efficient with that process, but there's not a lot of process to what we're doing.
Well, I think keeping things simple, has always been a modicum of, the sector itself. Better restaurants operate with fewer SKUs. You're limiting, and we've seen more of this now with, what happened with the pandemic, just because of supply chain scenarios that played in it. So we saw and also digital menus that actually scaled down what used to be more complex menus. So all of that, I think people are learning from that. So I definitely would agree that you guys have kind of inherently built that into your system. So yes, good for you. All right, so let's last question line up here is, you know, we mentioned it early, and that is capital. Right now, we're getting ready to, feels like we're getting ready to enter into a recession. We'll see how things play out in 2023. Capital's getting a lot tighter here within the venture capital and also private equity scenarios. We track this space quite pretty heavily of who the money movers are. Do you think this is a area, and when I say more so time, meaning 2023, maybe 24, where we may see much less capital on the ground working in brands like yours? Or are you positive in the sense that maybe private equity is still going to continue to accelerate in this sector? What are your thoughts?
I wish I had a crystal ball on what private equity was going to do. I think that they sat on the sidelines for most of last year. So, I mean, they got to deploy the capital at some point, right, would be my opinion. I like our chances to get, you know, that, to get it. I like our chances for the banks to lean into our franchisees and help them develop. And it really comes down to the unit economics. Once you start leveraging that physical plant to the height that we are, you know, the bottom line is implied, but it is, you know, pretty awesome actually. So, I like our chances to get that capital. I think that there definitely need to be smart how you use it, value engineering, smaller footprints, alternate strategies, to do that. And we're exploring all of those things, but you know, it's nice to build, you know, a big, double lane drive through, mm-hmm, you know, prototype and see it fly.
Yeah, I was looking at your locations, just like in Texas, Addison. That's a big market. Their Beltline Road, I know that one. That's high retail. The throughput around that zone, that's got to be crazy through the roof.
Yeah.
Then you got Allen, Austin, right there. This is the Kitchen United setup that you've got there on Burnett Road.
Yeah. Okay. That's awesome. And that's in a steel building with no indication that we're even in there.
Wow.
And like I said, we're pumping up near $3 million in that market for one store. It's pretty awesome. Greenville's a really high profile location.
Now you've got a Denton store here. That brings up a question for me, because Denton is kind of a secondary market to North Dallas, for people who know Texas. Do you find good, well, real estate, usually you can find really good real estate in those markets, but it's kind of a tier two. Do you think that the tier twos are potentially growth areas for brands like yours in next year and beyond?
I definitely think, I mean, we're doing really well in Denton and a lot of those. Coming out of Kansas City, the Denton, I agree with you, in the DFW market, I would call it a tier two, but we're right next to University of North Texas, Texas Women's, I mean, that store does really well. It really does. So
Denton's a nice town. I mean, it's a great community, but it, you know, in comparison, say like, you know, something like, if you look in North Tech, well, like what you've done in Addison, just, if you look in North Dallas and some of the Frisco would be another market. I'm just looking at those in the essence of what's like a tier one, tier two. I was looking at, you had Kyle, Texas in here. I would say, you know, kind of a growth market. Live Oak, you know, another, you know, kind of outer lying. Murphy, kind of same thing there. And then Rowlett, you've got Rowlett, Texas, which is down there. And then San Marcos, which down in South Texas towards San Antonio. This is a good growth schedule. I think with looking at your roadmap with franchising, what you guys are doing with AUVs, what's the unit economic right now for a build out? If I'm a franchisee, I get ready, I'm gonna say, hey, I wanna jump into one of these things. What's my build out looking like? Because some of these were freestanding.
Yeah, I should have had my FDD open in front of me, but we've built them in the, I think the range is 1.7 to close to 3 million.
Would that be more like a freestanding versus like an end cap where you could still get a
We've done a
drive-through?
lot of remodels. The concept does really well remodeling second gen QSR or some of the smaller casual diners, steak and shakes, and we've converted a lot of taco cabanas and pollo tropicals. A lot of conversions. I mean, 30 plus of those are conversions, and then we've got a couple of three ground ups, and then a few more prototypes coming out of the ground. But the ground ups are the higher on that.
Interesting stuff.
Yeah, I mean,
you guys are doing some pretty cool things.
Yeah, we're looking for any way we can get that food out because the consumer responds so well to it. And we've just delivered in so many different methods, whether it be the ghost kitchens and the various varieties of ghost kitchens, whether they have a customer center or they're just delivery only. We've found interesting all of those paths.
Yeah. Last question to you. You look at 2023. Is there one thing you guys have put up on the bullseye in your office and said, guys, we got to do that?
Grow digital. We're leaning into it. I think it's a big opportunity for us to continue to expand there. I want to stay out on the front end of it, look for any ways that we can to get better and faster, more efficient, try to increase. We have a very high success rate of customer satisfaction in all other channels, and delivery is one where we're handing the transaction to a third party. And so there's a trust factor there. We don't have, a huge problem there, but it is from a performance standpoint, the highest, miss that we have is what happens after we've handed it to a delivery driver. So we have a very high standard in that. So we with a 4.73 star rating, we look at each 1- and 2-star review every single week. We read it out loud to the group. We have a meeting we call the film room every Friday morning to review all the – it's like a championship football team that reviews game footage. We review every single customer review, the negatives. And like last week was 14 on 116,000 transactions. So
that's pretty
14
good.
Negative reviews. It's four sigma. That's what it is. We look at it like a manufacturing problem. We're striving for six sigma, and we had 14 issues on 120,000 transactions. So that's good, but not good enough. We want to limit those. They were all, the human mistakes that we can get better.
In the restaurant business, that's typically the problem is the human error. So definitely an interesting one. Stick around for after the show. Scott Ford, president and co-CEO over at Hawaiian Bros. So thanks for stopping in today. I appreciate it.
Hey, thank you very much.
You bet. All right. So you guys are tuned in over here on the podcast. We'd love to catch you on our video version now. Check out our YouTube channel. We just recently relaunched our YouTube channel for Foodable. Primarily, as you guys know, this is a podcast network. The video side of that you can catch at foodabletv.com or just go search Foodable Podcast Network on YouTube. You'll find us over there as well. If you have some ideas for a show, drop some ideas down in the comments below and make sure and smash the like button. It does help this podcast and a lot of our shows make its way into the mainstream out there. And if you guys have a question or you want someone on our shows, send a note to us, which is just producer@foodabletv.com. We'll catch you next time right here on the Restaurant Report.